October has been an amazing month. I went to DEF CON. It was cool to travel to Colombia. It was the first time of me being in South America. And, you know, then I took 2 weeks off, so I just got back. It feels great and really energizing. I suggest that. I haven't taken time off for 2 years. And definitely recommend, helps you with the mental health. But it also has been a record-breaking month for crypto. As you see at the bottom there, Hacktober, 44 exploits, that's a record. 3 billion year to date has been lost, which is also a record. We have the best, most successful year so far. And with that, basically, why I'm saying all this is because the security in this technology doesn't get better automatically. Like, we have many teams around focusing on security, how we can build like better tools, better practices, and create bulletproof code. But that's, even though can get better, we'll never get to the point of no hacks, no exploits. People make mistakes, people write code, and that's normal. That's just the reality. Like, from first principles, I do not believe that we can build bulletproof protocols that will never lose any money in kind of unintended fashion. So because of that, the need for insurance, I think, is quite apparent, and very few people argue actually with that. However, right now, we know the landscape of all the problems that we have, and teams try to do their best. Some don't care so much and, you know, just winging it. It's okay. We are very much in experimentation phase. But then paired with all that we're doing, we need to scale up the whole insurance industry. And so far that has not been very successful, as probably most of you know. The traction is very low. The main problem is, I guess, lack of underwriting capital, because insurance is all built around capital efficiency, on like leveraging on your capital in order to produce yield. Right now, as you know, a liquidity provider or a guy with some cash, I want to make more money. I'm not going to put money in insurance protocol for whatever reason. It's sometimes trust, because obviously all the protocols are levered, and so you have to kind of trust that they're not going to go into default. That's one problem, but then also because the demand is questionable and everyone tries different products to see and test the market where the actual need is coming from. Because the early assumption was, hey, like, everyone wants to stay protected, but that's not true. Usually, you know, most of us here, I think, are kind of DeFi enthusiasts and technologists. We're okay with just aping or like deploying a bunch of cash like on different protocols. And then overall, like, that plays out if you're diversified well. But then the reality today is the numbers are pretty low. And all the protocols that are out there don't really have a lot of capital compared to all the DeFi TVLs. And everyone tries to tackle problems from different aspects. That's why I personally like our niche very much, because literally everyone here does completely different thing. And so there are a lot of ideas. It is very friendly environment, and we're not really limited by competitive, you know, advantages, which is feels good right now. However, I mean, the problem is still there, and it's been like 2 years of, you know, a lot of active development by many teams. There are also some new protocols, and they try to hit other niches, but then everyone kind of battles with the same challenges. So today, I'm not really coming with so many answers, but I just want to intellectually engage you, steer some ideas, maybe bring on the light of the stuff that we're working on, what experiments our other teams are doing, just so you become a little more aware. And I'll start in the reverse order now. So the reinsurance market, there's a new team called Re, and it's really cool to see, you know, like a new wave of projects that try to go in the real world aspect. So this reinsurance market what they actually start or like trying to achieve, and they just raise some capital, is taking reinsurance market for a traditional insurance firm and just executing that stuff on chain. So, you know, or heard of Lloyd's, they are the biggest reinsurance market right now. Basically, most of the insurance firms around the world, they trade their long tail risk. By long tail, I mean kind of your risk of default or maybe like not having enough operating capital to pay down the claims. So that's what they're after. It has nothing to do with DeFi, but I thought it would be cool to bring this up. Real world assets is something different teams talked about over the last like few years. The real motivation there is that in insurance, you want to be diversified. You want to take a bunch of uncorrelated risks because then you can take on more risk and make more money off of it. So Nexus Mutual has voiced the intent to do that. I don't have any intel how far they've gotten, but it's not really live yet. Nimble is another team that just getting started there. And the idea is, at least like for Nexus, you know, they can take on a bunch of DeFi risk, but then also leverage on their capital with some real world insurances. And so that should increase the yield and the utility of the capital that they can provide. Then RCA, it stands for Reciprocally Covered Assets, and it's been launched by Ease, I think just a few months ago. Ease is, you probably heard of ArmorFi. They just kind of created no KYC wrapper for Nexus Mutual. But now they actually have their own like new major push, the product they rebranded for Ease. And the way I understood it in the simple terms is it's sort of a mutual. Basically, they say it's a no premium insurance, but obviously there's no free lunch, you know. And what you do is you take your tokens and wrap them in a vault. And all the different people like rep their yield-bearing tokens in different vaults. And if some of those tokens takes a loss because of a hack or exploit or some like devaluation of that token, then they rebalance all the vaults. So basically by wrapping your assets, if something happens to your assets, then everyone else pays you back. But then again, if somebody else gets hacked, you will lose part of your kind of like deposit there. So it is very interesting to watch how like people react because, you know, of course, people are always willing to give up their risk, maybe like pay a little for it, but then when you cannot account for the losses you might take on that, that makes people a little more like wary and not and hesitant to partake. And the last one is actually the new product that we've been working on for the past like half the year and actually started like envisioning it about a year ago. We call it Solus Native, and it is basically inspired by FDIC in a sense that we want to create a federated insurance system for the DAOs. So the protocols should take, it is my belief, a responsible approach. We say customer protection is kind of like one of the terms, but I think every industry around the world benefited from that and allowed users to actually, if not blindly, but comfortably just engage with the products. Today, as protocols in DeFi, we ask people to read the docs, you know, to trust our audits. But then it takes a lot of time and work for the users. And if we want to see the mass adoption, I think it's expected that the user should just come in your app and just buy or like use whatever tool we make. At least a streamlined activity would benefit us all. And of course, there are more components to it. A lot of people focus on UI, UX design and just like making it easier because, you know, even getting your own wallet is a kind of like a problem sometimes. But with the native insurance, the idea is fairly simple. All the protocols come together and put a bunch of their token into the system that is leveraged as like an underwriting capital, but then it makes them economically enticed to sort of follow the best practices and the rules that the whole federated system puts on the protocols. And then if something goes wrong, you know that you're going to get a payout. And so that allows the protocols that participate in the system basically guarantee to their users that if we're going to get exploited, we're going to get a payout that we will either transfer to make the protocol whole again. You know, sometimes you can just refill the vault and everyone is happy. But then another way is just to pay the users back. And so some of the interesting things that we thought we should leverage is the native tokens. That's part of the reason why we call this native, is because everyone tries to underwrite with the liquid assets is like ETH or stable coins. And especially right now in the bear market, it's really tough to get fresh capital, especially externally. But then even within the ecosystem, that's really scarce. And that's kind of the reason why. So what we're forming is, you can think of it as an index of all the different tokens of the different protocols that they contribute from their treasuries. I think it's no secret that every protocol sits on a like fairly big treasuries, just full of their tokens that are only of paper value. Like, you know, we have millions of dollars of Solus token, and I can't sell it. I can't really do much with it. It's just there as a paper money. But then there's still a way to utilize that, and that's where we plan to harvest a lot of value for, like, this insurance system. But then, of course, as a federated approach, we want to drive the security, and we've been partnering with a lot of different security agents, you know, smart contract monitoring. So insurance doesn't really work without the security measures that are hard in place. If you look at the real world insurance, you have the governments that mandate certain rules and make companies follow those, makes, you know, users to do certain actions, and that allows insurance firms to actually evaluate all the risks. If we're an insurance protocol that can do whatever they want and we have no visibility into it, there's kind of no way to manage the risk and evaluate and like assess all of that. And so that's the problem with a lot of products. You know, sometimes people or like protocols or developers come like, hey, like, you know, can I get insurance for this and can I get insurance for that? Given the bear market, I always say yes. You know, we could use money, but in reality, that's more of a joke sometimes, because if we don't know how we can evaluate the risk, then there's no reason or way to ensure that. So with the lack of regulatory frameworks or hard rules that the teams or the protocols have to follow, we need to incentivize them to use the best practices, and there are different ways to do it. Another thing that we did in like launch at the beginning of the year was the portfolio insurance. It takes a very different approach from what every other protocol does, in a sense that most of them sell you a policy for a protocol. So if you deploy capital to, let's say, like BadgerDAO or like Aver, you would buy a policy for that set exposure. We wanted to make it easier for the users and asset managers in like CeFi, because imagine if you're managing a portfolio of like 10 different exposures, you need 10 different policies. If you exit, oftentimes you cannot cancel the policy. So there's a lot of like friction, and we wanted to streamline that. So we thought, let's focus on the address and ensure the address, so you can just continue on with your yield farming and don't worry about insurance. So the portfolio insurance actually is a policy that you buy for your address, and then you deploy capital across four chains, over 220 protocols, you're insured everywhere. It's dynamic and you only pay for what you use. Every 6 hours it updates. So you're always, you know, staying covered throughout your journey. And that creates some actually like benefits to us, even though we maybe are not able to like see the future of, okay, where are you gonna put your money? But it creates much more diversified portfolio of risk for us. But then obviously you can benefit from it because your coverage limit that you usually set on your individual policies is a single one for your whole address. And so the more diversified your portfolio is, the cheaper is the insurance. So that's another ongoing experiment, but you know, really it's pretty much like a finished baked out product. And right now we're only limited by the amount of underwriting capital we can sell. So it, yeah, it's usually just sold out, but then because it's still very little amount, we cannot like deeply lever into it. That's sort of like the challenge we're in right now. So I guess the question really I wanted to pose on this talk is if we can come up with like some more creative designs, because the truth is everyone looks at the traditional insurance thing, okay, like what are they doing well, and then try to just port it over and slap a bunch of like different tokenomics. I mean, there's like VE, we have a bunch of staking, we have yield farming. We have been bonding actually, so we were the first protocols, and I think the only one. I believe one of the Solana insurance protocols also followed the bonding model. So basically, we are the only EVM DeFi insurance protocol that actually acquires the underwriting capital. So while everyone tries to attract it externally, we buy it up because then it makes it easier for us to pay claims. There are less of like incentives challenges, because if it's somebody else's capital that you need to pay out, it's, you know, how do you do it? You can force them, but then people get pissed and then they don't put the money in. And so there are all these issues. But then there are a bunch of like new ideas that we've been thinking about is, okay, what if we can underwrite with illiquid assets or pay claims with illiquid assets? Do people like need stablecoin payouts? Intuitively, yes. Like you usually want to, you know, get your money back if you get hacked, and not just in some like token that you cannot use. But if you could use it, and if it's like a fundamental block of like DeFi that then you can just move on with, maybe that would be okay and acceptable. In that whole challenge of like just underwriting capital is like pretty big. But then also you see all the DeFi protocols sort of like build this like insurance model and then slap the token on top. They use it to attract capital. They use it for like voting or like staking to whether like assess risk or assess claims or do something. But then maybe we can integrate more and create more like gamified model. Like you can, you know, imagine what if you buying an insurance equates to you just buying a token. That's, you know, like one like simple idea, but like people don't really like haven't really done that much. So then some others is just claims processing. I think that's where you as a user, as like insurance buyer start. You wouldn't want to buy a policy if you're not sure that you're going to get a payout back. So that's at least where my journey started. I remember, you know, in 2020, like watching Nexus Mutual launch, and I thought that it's suboptimal and like that's not a product that I would use, and that's what put me like on the path to go this way. But still today, claims are pretty suboptimal. Like there's very little confidence that you're gonna get a payout, and usually it's either relying on the trust of the protocol is like faithful. We see like InsurAce, you know, does pay claims, which is nice, but then they can also like not pay claim. And with like Nexus Mutual, with the whole like problem on incentives, we know like there are a bunch of claims that should have been paid but haven't gotten paid. And so a lot of teams look at like outsourcing claims to a third party. So Uma and Claros both like offer those kind of services. And you know, we worked with both, but then still you could think, you know, there are all these like token problems of like 51% attacks, because like some of the claims have not been faithfully paid. And when we look of like, okay, can we have like a separate party outside of the protocol that can basically process the claims? Unfortunately, the trigger-based claims are really hard to like execute, and like making it purely quantitative or automatic is still sort of like a dream we strive to achieve. You still need human interaction there and kind of like look, because all these exploits are sometimes brilliant, but like really tough to like quantify or create automated systems that just evaluate whether it's a valid claim or not, or if there was a loss. And another interesting idea, and actually like a lot of investors that we talk to, you know, say, hey, like you should have more actuaries. Like they believe that that will solve the problem. And I'm smiling because that's, I mean, somewhat true. Like, yeah, there's always more intelligence you could use. But then even right now, we do have like enough intelligence from like the traditional world and traditional actuaries to, you know, evaluate the risk and try to like assess that. So that's not really like an underpinning challenge, but then we could use more intelligence, like with risk management, especially when you try to predict the future. I mean, like that's what we do, right? Like we just look at our portfolio of like risk and try to see how much money we're gonna lose. That's the whole goal. Like if we can gauge pretty well how much money we're gonna lose, then we can make money on it. And that's where you could use like actuaries, but that's the work that people need to be doing. And it doesn't work when you just try to use wisdom of a crowd. Like if we all just vote of like, okay, what is the risk of, you know, event A, we're gonna be far off the actual value. And so it takes intelligent work and, you know, full-time people. So creating the network where we could like incentivize more financial mathematicians and individuals that already have the skills but don't really know how to like port them into crypto, because what we were kind of surprised to see, we thought that it's going to be a big challenge to like actually like attracting like traditional risk managers. But we have done our risk management, risk assessment. Everything is open source, all the numbers, all the analytics, all the models. And we're like, want to be very transparent, I guess, just for the philosophy of it. But then the side effect of that was that we got a bunch of cool people in our Discord from like the traditional insurance firms. And so I can firmly say that there is a lot of interest out there, and people just don't know what to do in crypto. Like if you talk to like an actuary that, you know, works at Lloyd's, a lot of people are excited by crypto, but they don't know if they could use their craft that they already well know. And so I think we could tap into that more through proper incentives in tokenomics. There's probably more, I mean, but yeah, so the few like new things that we've been working on, we know like some other teams also pursue that, is one of the big ones are audits. Like right now we know that, okay, audit is a good practice. Everyone is getting audits, but then you don't really have this repercussions if, you know, you got audited and then you got hacked. The auditors are not like really liable for any of that. So you have this like little like broken incentives thing. In a lot of teams, especially like auditors, like maybe mostly auditors want to have now insurance with their audits. And so that's where we started working with some into like creating that product. So I think over the next year, you will see a lot more auditors being able to like actually offer insurance with their audits. And of course, like that's better for the teams. You, as a new project or like you launching a new product, you get audited, and then that already gives confidence to the users. And so the user doesn't have to buy insurance. Really, that's where we want to push the space, where the users don't really have to worry about all these niche risks that are very tough to like analyze and evaluate. I mean, your best practice right now is just to diversify across a bunch of different protocols. But then I think we can do better. Reinsurance is another important one. As I already like mentioned earlier, like some teams started working on that, and it might sound counterintuitive, like we still don't have insurance and then we're already trying to build like reinsurance, but those two kind of come together because we're insuring a bunch of stuff. We also want to get insurance for our own skin, so that would be nice. Also recently, we have a lot of, I think, talks and Gauntlet launch is launching like DAO treasury management platform. I think it's called Era. But then there, I think Mimic is also, so there are a bunch of new projects and protocols that pursue DAO treasury management and try to like hedge the risk on that front, because, I mean, in reality, like most of the protocols are pretty bad at managing their treasuries. I know like we've made tons of mistakes that cost us money, and we could have done better over the last years. And with that, okay, cool. Yeah, with that, like, I think there are a lot more options and tools we can provide and like build for the DAO treasuries, because protecting kind of like the teams and the protocols, it's easier and almost better than just trying to like go direct to the consumer, because the users are might not be like aware of certain little things around the risks. DNO stands for Directors and Operators Insurance. That's something that you see a lot in different traditional industries. So if you are, you know, like a founder or something goes wrong, you get sued, you can get protected by that insurance. And we know that in crypto, founders do expose themselves to like a lot of risks. Even when we're all, you know, faithful developers, I guess not all, but you know, most of us are builders, like we're still exposed to a lot of risks, and some insurance there, it could be nice. At least like I would use it. But yeah, credit default swaps is another big thing. We see more and more protocols trying to do under collateralized lending or like lending to institutions and all that. And so that really opens up a pretty cool avenue of like credit default swaps. We know how huge the market is in the traditional world with that. So these are just a few things that are kind of like in the pipeline right now. So yeah, like stay tuned. But then yeah, like we're not the only protocol that like working on these things, and I'm really excited to see where we can take this. So yeah, given the time, I'm just gonna close with that. Like my belief is that insurance should be built into like the foundation of DeFi. It is built in every industry because there's certain layer of protection that we need to provide to the users if we really want to see any scale. And so, I mean, my job is to build better products, you know, get better product market fit, make the products cheaper, because the problem with like capital and, you know, like the cost of it is just the spread between how much money you have to pay versus how much money the investors are paying, like underwriters, is still like pretty big, right? So that's what all the teams try to like close down the gap. And once we get closer to it, there's gonna be a lot more traction and attention and fun. So with that, I'll finish. Thank you very much. Oh, by the way, also disclaimer, like we have nothing to do with Solana. Yeah, it's way before that.
You were saying in a part of the talk that your business in a sense is like predicting the future, right? And the better you can do it, the better you can profit, or the better you can lower your costs and serve, continue to serve your users. And I'm wondering what is missing there. Like, how can you do that better, or what is missing there? Is it data? Is it the models? How to improve on that?
Yeah. So the models are not actually that much of an issue, even though we do have very little history. I mean, really, that has been 2 years, and using 2 years of data isn't really often so good at like predicting, so you have to build in more like safety factors and all of your models. But as I said at the end, like the problem is like closing that gap, because insurance really works at scale. Diversification of the risk allows you to lever on your capital. If you have $1 million and you're trying to insure $2 million, your yield on that is still going to be pretty low. And because of that, it's really hard to attract more capital. So there's this like chicken and egg problem that everyone faces. The cold start of like insurance is really tough because, yeah, like just with low capital, you cannot insure a lot. If you have 100 million, you know, you could like insure 200 to 50, 100 million dollars fairly comfortably, and then generate yield on that you can like pass on to your capital providers. And that also allows you to drive down the premium. You know, right now, kind of like the best rates are around 2% like annualized premium. So like if you're insuring $100,000, you would pay like $2,000. And that sort of like burns a lot of users and kind of like stops them. But that's only for the safe protocols. Like who the fuck wants to insure Uniswap V2? Like, I mean, I don't think it's ever gonna get broken. But then with the new tools, really, you know, it's, you can get up to like, you know, 10% or like 15%. Right now across the board, we see 5% is like the break-even point. Like if you insure the entire space, and like you can charge like 5%. And so like that would like pay down like all the losses and stuff. And over time it actually is decreasing. Like, you know, we are getting better, even though the numbers are still pretty big. Like the risk rating on the capital is actually like going down. So, you know, once it hits below like 2 or 1%, then it's going to be like very like easily accessible. It'll be like easier to attract the capital too. And so right now everyone launching and operating at small scale has to like charge a ton of money and then take on a lot more risk. You know, we are all pretty much like, if you compare it to like the traditional standards, are like way, way risky than anything. And I mean, like when people like talk about insurance smart contracts, you know, sometimes they just think it's like not worth it right now.